Hello, Susanna.
Hello, Paul. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Hi, Sian.
Hello, Sian. Another dinky. Good afternoon. Only a cat like you. Only a cat like you, only a cat like you, only a cat like you.
Yeah. For the places of man, I will never ever stand. To the kingdoms of this world, I'll never give my heart away or shout my praise. My allegiance and devotion, my heart's desire and all emotion, but to serve the man who died upon the tree. Only a God like you can be worthy of my praise and all my honor and fame. Only a King of all kings will I bow my knee and sing, give my everything. Only a God like you can be worthy of my praise and all my hope and faith. To only a King of all kings will I bow my knee and sing, give my everything. To only my Maker, my Father, my Savior, Redeemer, Restorer, Rebuilder, Rewarder. To only a God like you, I give you my praise. Come
on.
For the praises of man, I will never ever stand. To the kingdoms of this world, I'll never give my heart away or shout my praise. My allegiance and devotion, my heart's desire and all emotion, but to serve the man who died upon the tree.
Welcome, Brother Domar, Sis Maurice, Sister.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Hi, Sis Lani. Sis Lani from Davao.
Hi, Sis Lani.
Yes, sis.
Welcome, Sis Lani.
Hi, Ronalyn.
Hi, Ronalyn from Davao.
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the first timers.
Yes.
Hello, sis.
Thank you for joining us.
Helen, good afternoon.
Hi,
I can bless you. Welcome.
Hi, Sis Restu.
Hello.
Our birthday celebrants, Sis Malen. Sis Marvi, Sis Brother Ed.
Brother Dave! Hello!
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the feast, the place where you are loved and the place where you find rest. Welcome to our series, Side A, Side B, Talk Number 2, Sinking Feet and Desperate Cries. We are so happy that you're joining us today and being a part of our talk series. We would like to give a warm welcome to our first-timers. First-timers, please wave. Give us a thumbs up. If this is your first time, please check the link in the chat and fill out the form. And if you have prayer requests, please fill out the form and our intercessory team will take care of your prayers. We also encourage you to stay after the talk and join our breakout rooms. This is an informal session. You can just listen or share your reflections. So we hope that you will be blessed. We believe the talk will speak to you today. Brothers and sisters, I will not keep you waiting. Let's give our praises to God and join our English feast worship as we sing Alive.
Hello Feast! Hello fams! Welcome to the feast today, and are you ready to praise God? So, just because He's alive in us forever and ever, so let's go praise Him!
Lost with a broken heart, you picked me up, now I'm set apart. From the ash I'm born again, forever safe in the Savior's hand. You are more than my words can say. I'll follow you, love, for all my days. I fix my eyes following your ways, forever free in an endless grace.
Come in.
You are, you are, you are my freedom. We lift you higher, your love, your love, your love, never ending. Oh, oh, oh. You are alive in us, nothing can take your place. You are all we need, your love I say, I scream. Whoa.
Of the darkest night,
let your love be the shining light. Make a chance that you're holding me. You set your sun down and set me free. Everything in the world will fade. I'm pressing on till I see your face. I believe that your will be done. And I will to higher, lift to higher. Your love, never ending flow. Oh, oh, you are not in us, nothing can take your place. You are all we need. Your love, I say, as you will. You are alive in us. Nothing can save your flesh. You are all we need. Your love has set us free. Whoa. Whoa. You are my freedom. We lift to higher, lift to higher. Your love, never ending. Oh, you are my freedom. We lift to higher, lift to higher. Your love, never ending.
English Feast Worship for that beautiful song. Let's all welcome our eloquent preacher, Brother Dan.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. It's me again, your brother Dan Javier, coming to you live from my apartment. And I'm very welcome to all of you. Welcome to the English Feast Jakarta, to the place and the time where the blessings and the love of the Lord comes to you. A blessed time for us to refresh our souls and to recharge our faith journey. Amen. I would also like to say a warm welcome to our newcomers. You have come to the right place and a time to be blessed. In behalf of the English Feast community, we honor your presence and we praise and thank God for your being with us. For almost 2 years now, we've been traveling to the Gospel of Matthew. Wow, 2 years already. Chapter by chapter, verse by verse, broken down into several talk series. And our talk series today is called Side A, Side B. As we break down the stories, we allow the text as divinely inspired to speak to our hearts and touch our lives. This afternoon will be no different, and we will all anticipate a tremendous blessing for today. Amen. And today, as we desire to be blessed so we can bless others, let us say hallelujah and praise the Lord. Because today, our talk is called Side A and Side B. Brother Pete explained in his last talk that the fourth part of Matthew's Gospels, that is chapter 14 to chapter 20, we're nearing already the second half. This is a team of two sides. We playfully call this Side A, Side B, just like a cassette tape. For those of you who are as old as me, you would know what that is. All the talks in this series have two things, two stories, two kingdoms, two kings, two parties. The two sides of the story today is called Sinking Feet and Desperate Cries. So this talk is called Sinking Feet and Desperate Cries. To many, This might be a scary title. To many, this might be a scary title, but this is going to refresh you and encounter our Lord, hopefully in a very personal way. Brothers and sisters, the essence of this talk is whatever state you are in your life, whether you're lonely, you need a job, you're struggling in your business, or maybe you're sick, I pray that our God who heals and provides may journey with you. So don't let this title of this talk scare you, but give you hope and strength as we are going to tackle one of the most interesting stories in the Bible. You see that picture? Yes, we will be talking about a very familiar story to all of you. Jesus walking in the water. And do you see who is in that picture? That is Peter, who walked on water with Jesus. And I hope that despite you knowing this story and heard sermons on this for several times, you may be still refreshed to see this in a new, refreshing, and more enlightened way. Brothers and sisters, you know, 6 years ago, this story resonated so much in my personal life, it changed me in a big way. More than that, I will tell you about that later. So let's pray our feast declaration prayer now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today, I receive all of God's love for me. Today, I open myself to the unbounded, limitless, overflowing abundance of God's universe. Today, I open myself to God's blessings, healings, and miracles. Today, I open myself to God's word, so I become more like Jesus every day. Today, I proclaim that I am God's beloved. I am God's servant. I am God's powerful champion. And because I am blessed, I am blessing this world in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us all sing and honor God's word. Thy word is the lamp upon my feet and the light unto my path. Today, I'd like to preach the message, God will rescue you. Can you say that to the person beside you? Tap his shoulders. Come on. Tell him, God will rescue you. I want you to do also one thing. Close your eyes. Come on, don't be shy. No, God is just watching you. Nobody's watching you but God. Close your eyes. Say this with conviction. Now follow me. Hands on your heart. Close your eyes. And say it with belief. Three times. Once, God will rescue me. Twice, God will rescue me. Thrice, God will rescue me. Amen? Type amen in the chat box if you want. The reason we went to that exercise is that I want you to really believe it. Ask me why. Because as we read one of the most told stories in the Bible, Jesus walking on water, I hope that you will still be amazed, because no matter how many times we've read and heard, God speaks of something new. This is because his word is timeless. It's like a fountain that refreshes us anew every time we go back to his word. And our Bible story starts this way. Remember, God's word is alive and he wants to speak with you. Let's read the scriptures with me. Immediately after this, God insisted his disciples to get back to the boat and cross on the other side of the lake while he sent the people home. After sending them home, he went up to the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone. Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from the land, for a strong wind had risen, and they were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came towards them, walking on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost." But Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." Then Peter called to him, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you, walking on the water." "Yes, come," Jesus said. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water towards Jesus. When he saw the strong wind and waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. "You have so little faith," Jesus said. "Why did you doubt me?" Brothers and sisters, let's come to prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We praise and thank you, Lord, for today, for gathering us together to hear your word. Bless all of us who are gathered in faith to know you more. May your Holy Spirit be upon us. Open our minds, open our hearts, so we may walk with you in our journey of faith. This we ask in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And I invite you to sing Psalm 119, verse 105. "Thy word is the lamp unto my feet, and the light unto my path." You see, last week, prior to this story, Brother Pete preached to you. In the beginning of that story, John the Baptist was executed. It was a sad moment. But what did Jesus do amidst his sorrow? In this story, after the feeding of the 5,000, it was a joyful moment. In fact, it was so miraculous that Jesus was really seen as the new Moses, the one giving bread, feeding the people of God. But what did he do amidst all of this joy? I will give you a clue. Let's look at the first part of this passage. Immediately after this, it says, Jesus insisted his disciples to get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake. While he went, he sent the people home. After sending them home, listen to this, he went up to the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone. You know, after reading this passage, Jesus is trying to show us something here. During Brother Pete's talk last time, we recall that Jesus had a sad moment when John the Baptist was executed. He wanted to be alone. To do what? To pray. Although Jesus was not successful because there was a lot of crowd following him, this time, after the feeding of the 5,000, it was a joyous moment. Jesus wanted to go to a lonely place again. He dismissed the crowds and went up to the hills. To what? To pray. Jesus, in the most significant events of his life, whether it is sad or joyful events, did not make those circumstances define him. He focused on communing with the Father. Before we go on walking in the water story, there is a lesson here. And what is that? Brothers and sisters, in the events of your life, just like Jesus, the Father and Jesus had their alone time. And this is the first message of this talk. God wants a one-on-one on you. God wants to talk to you. You may ask me, really, Brother Dan, God wants to talk to you? Many people ask me, how does God talk to you? Does he appear to you? Does he whisper to your ears? Do the clouds part amidst the thunder and lightning and talk to you? Let me tell you this. God talks to us, one, in the silence of our hearts in prayer. Two, he talks to us in scriptures. Three, he talks to us through people, most especially the people of the faith community. And in this talk, he concretely talks to us, number four, in the circumstances and the events of our life, whether sad situations or happy moments. May I honor Manny Pacquiao? Why do I honor Manny Pacquiao? You know, the world is watching him. Millions of people are watching him. After a victory or a loss, what does he do? He shuts off everything. He goes to his corner. He kneels down and pray. He's happy or sad, no? But why do most of us only have a one-on-one meeting with the Lord during sad moments? Maybe it is when we are sad or with struggles that we mostly call on him. To those who are struggling with their relationships, struggling with their careers, finances, business, or health, when you're trying to decide what to do, as you read books or ask well-meaning friends what to do, I like to tell you something. At a certain point, you need to stop listening to the crowd. There will be advices from well-meaning friends. They are welcome. You know, I read the book by Brené Brown, and I tell my family that lesson is that you should have a list placed in a 1-inch by 1-inch paper of who you can be vulnerable with. Brené Brown was a brilliant writer, and she said, make sure in that list, which is very short because only 1 by 1, this is a list of people who will have your best interest and who love you most. Even with that, I dare say that at a certain point, we need to check our hearts and our motives. What do I mean? Listen, what we need to check is if we are praying, what? That our problems go away. And beware, that kind of thinking will not bear fruit. If we pray that our problems would go away. Of course, we want our problems to go away. But let's consider two things. Number one, don't pray for an easy life. Pray for a meaningful life. Marriage, together with its challenges, is supposed to be a happy burden. Parenting, together with its challenges, is supposed to be a happy burden. Ministry, our service, together with its challenges, is supposed to be a happy burden. Work, business, yes, together with its challenges, should be a happy burden. We are burdened and tired at the end of the day, but we are happy. Because at the end of the day, what? Marriage is a blessing. Parenting is a blessing. Our service and ministry, it is a blessing. Our work, our business, is a blessing. And all blessings carry happy burden, happy burdens. Remember, I told you that God talks to you in the circumstances and events of your life. Examine your problems. And here is the second thing. Following Jesus isn't about avoiding problems. It is about transforming your problems for his glory. In your problems, what is God telling you behind your struggles? Let me ask you, Are you going to be defined by the events and circumstances around you, or are you above them? Another question. Is he asking you to give up something? Maybe, is he asking you to forgive? Is he asking you to surrender something? And this is very beautiful. This comes from my mother. Can you be able to find the gift beneath your pain? I'll repeat that. Can you be able to find the gift beneath your pain? Remember the first message? God wants you to have a one-on-one on me. And here is the second message for today. God will allow you to enter storms. Nowhere in the Bible or in the teaching of the church did God promise that life would be easy. In fact, he asks us to carry our cross. The truth is, as followers of Christ, we need to die to ourselves to be his disciples. Look at the lives of the apostles and saints. Their life was not easy. But what was his promise? He promised us a spirit of strength, peace, and joy that the world cannot give. In our reading, you do not need to be a Bible scholar to see that Jesus sent these apostles to see. And what happened to them? Don't you think it was not foreknown to Jesus that there was going to be a storm? And Jesus loved his disciples, right? God allows you to enter storm. Not only storm, storms, plural. But why does he allow us to enter storms? Before I answer, let me state one thing very clear. And many of us think this way. I'm guilty of this. I did. The storms of our lives are not God's punishment. How many of think like this? How many of us think like this? God is punishing me for my sins. That is, he's punishing me for my sins mentality. Number one. Number two, another mentality. How many of us think like this? God has abandoned me. He has forsaken me mentality. So why does God allow us to enter storms? Ask me why. I have a three-worded answer. Are you ready? Okay, the three-word answer is, I don't know. I don't know. And you know, I'm trying to learn, or learning to be comfortable with that, because I don't entirely know or comprehend his great infinite wisdom, but I believe he wants us to smash our attachment to the false and empty sense of security that this world offers. That's why he gives us storms. And I believe the storms of our life, viewed from different lens. So one, our storms are windows for healing. Our storms are taking a road for us to have a significant purpose. The storms of our life is the birthplace of mercy and grace. Because what does the world teach us? Trust in your financial security. You wake up one day, a bad business deal happens, you lose everything. Or you wake up one day to no fault of yours, you lose your job. You feel perfectly fine and healthy, and you find out you have health issues and you have a health crisis. Your friends you trust one day, then they betray or abandon you. Why do I say these things? Because this is the story of my life and the story of many others. And I'm sure in some ways, this is your story too. Because when all of your finances, your health, your friends are gone, we can focus and trust the one who can command the turbulent storms, who can command the turbulent storms and focus our hearts to be still. And come to the realization and say to ourselves, what? I will not let the trust in the Lord die in my heart. Amen. Meanwhile, let's read the scriptures. They said, meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from the land, for a strong wind had risen and they were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came towards them, walking in the water. Brothers and sisters, aside from the obvious reason that Jesus allows his disciples to enter the storm, what else struck you in this passage? What struck you in that passage? For me, it was this. At the fourth watch of the night, no watches like we have today, where we said first hour, nobody had watches like this. In the morning, they had the first to the 11th hour, that's 5 o'clock. And then the ancients divided nighttime into four watches. The first watch, 6 to 9 p.m. Second watch, 9 to 12 p.m. Third watch, midnight to 3 a.m. The fourth watch is 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. Jesus did not come on the first, nor the second or the third watch. He came at the fourth watch. Jesus did not come on that first three watches. And I know many of you can relate to this. Jesus comes at the darkest moment of the night, before dawn, just when you think all hope is lost. Jesus shows up. You see, God is never early. God is never late. He shows up on time. And his time is the right time. Do you know it took 490 years for Jesus to come after the Babylonian Empire? And there was no prophets. The Davidic kingdom was gone. There was no more temple. And there was no more King David. Are you waiting for a relationship to mend, brothers and sisters? Are you waiting for a business or your career to turn around? Are you waiting for a sickness to heal? A conversion of someone you love? Here's my third message to you. God's timing is perfect. So let's summarize so far. My first message is God wants a one-on-one message with you. Why? Why does he want a one-on-one with you? Be ready and prepared because, second message, because God will allow you to enter the storm. Here he will put your trust into a test and test him because my third message a while ago is that God will rescue you and his timing is perfect. And now here is my fourth message. God is still in charge. Let's continue with the scriptures. When the disciples saw him walking in the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost!" But Jesus spoke to them, "Don't be afraid. Take courage. I am here." You know, in ancient times, going to the ocean was a large risk. Imagine in those days, there were no sophisticated radars to accurately point the location or predict storms. These were not available. In case something goes wrong, there were no rescue teams with helicopters. The ocean was truly terrifying because you can really lose your life if a storm happens. This was the predicament of the disciples on the boat. Their lives were in danger. But let me tell you this powerful verse in Genesis. Listen well. Many of us are in a storm, right? How many of us are scared, bothered with anxiety? Listen. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the water. Where do we find this? This is the second verse in the Bible. Even before the world was created, in the Bible, barely told, the Old Testament proclaims and shouts the truth even before creation. God's Spirit was hovering over the waters. In the New Testament, Jesus walks over the waters. He manifests that he is above the storm. And here's the gospel message. That relationship that cannot be mended. Your breakup that you cannot go over with. That sin that you find difficult to surrender. That sickness that doesn't go away. Jesus will walk over it. What did Jesus say to the disciples on the boat? Don't be afraid. Take courage. I am here. Whatever challenges, brothers and sisters, you are facing to remember, God is in charge. Jesus is Lord over your chaos. Jesus is Lord over that divorce. Jesus is Lord over your backsliding into sin. Jesus is Lord over your loneliness or your anxiety. Jesus is Lord over this COVID. The Lord is still in control. Brothers and sisters, trust him. John 5:17 said, Jesus said, my Father is working still and I am working. So believe me when I say, Jesus, God will rescue you. Amen. Let's move on to our story. Then Peter said to him, Lord, if it is really you, tell me to come to you, walking over the water. Yes, come, Jesus said. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water towards Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind, the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. Save me, Lord, he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. You have so little faith, Jesus said. Why did you doubt me? You know, brothers and sisters, many, many times I can identify myself like Peter. High-spirited, volunteering, saying, yes, Lord, only to sink. I think many of us are like Peter. We succumb to the waves and the wind, and we get overwhelmed by the events, the circumstances, and the problems. And what happens, brothers and sisters? We fail to keep our eyes on Jesus. That really sounds like me, I say. I'm not consistent. I remember 6 years ago, during the dark period of my life, a friend, Brother Jimmy Oy, oddly a non-Catholic, opened his eyes using exactly this Bible story. Then I started to realize why I was sinking in my life. And I realized this. I realized what? Ask me what? I realized that we have a choice. In life, we have that power to choose. We can look at the wind and the waves around us, the circumstances and the problems, or the toxic people around us and worry. Or we can fix our eyes on Jesus and his love for you. He who can help you walk over the water, over your storms. And this is a powerful message. But as great as this message is, before we come to the end of this talk, I want you to understand the deeper truth of this story. You know, this story is not about you. It's not about your faith, but it is about how strong God's love for us really is. The Bible story, most of it, we, in essence, is never about us. You see, we have a tendency, when we read the Bible, we read it like an ethical book. You have to do this or do that, improve here, improve there, which is good. But before we make this story, about how our faith would measure up or how we measure up, this story is not about how strong our faith is, but this is a story about how our loving God behaves and how God loves us. You know, Matthew in this story is exposing God's heart. What was Matthew trying to say here? I said a while ago, I can identify with Peter, excited to serve, wanting to say yes to follow Jesus. But I'm very inconsistent, flaky, not dependable. Maybe some of you are like Peter also, like me. I would venture to say that maybe Matthew is saying we are all like Peter. I always find my faith and trust in him lacking. And guess what? We will all fail. And even if we fail, I want you to realize what Matthew is trying to say here. Oddly enough, Matthew in his gospel tells about his disciples having little faith. In contrast to those people who were supposed to have little faith, the Roman centurion, remember, before we receive communion, we say, Lord, I am not worthy. That belongs to the Roman centurion. The Canaanite woman who said that, you know, even the dogs of his master deserve the morsels. The faith that Jesus admired. You know, I always thought that faith is something inside us that you need to stir up. You need to cultivate. Yes, there's value into that. But in my spiritual journey, it tells only, that is only partly true. Ask me why. Because the ability to trust God is not of my own doing. It is a gift. Faith is a virtue, not like other virtues. The other virtues you can develop and you can learn them. They are what you call self-evident. This is a Thomasian way. Temperance. No, your innate passions of concupiscence, you can temper them. Your prudence in your decision making, you can do justice. What is due to others, you can give fortitude and courage to endure. No, but faith is a supernatural virtue. It is a gift, a grace that is not primarily our work, but we need to pray for it. You come to faith not on your own, not on your own merit. Your faith is a divine revelation that surpasses your intelligence, and it is a gift from God. But you say, Brother Dan, I think my faith isn't strong. Well, you need to work on it or meditate on it or read scripture. But most importantly, you need to pray. Ask God for the gift of faith. Why is faith important? I want now to end this talk with my fifth and final message, because it is the bookend for the first and the last message. Bookends containing valuable lessons of trust, mercy, and love. Your faith rescues. Your faith rescues, and God will rescue you by strengthening your faith. He will rescue you. He will strengthen your faith. Even if you lack faith, he will rescue you. Even if your faith is just like a mustard seed. Second is most radical. You know how loving our Lord is? Very radical. God will still rescue you even if you fail him. I ask you one thing. How many times in your life were you so undeservingly rescued? Despite our transgressions, we are so blessed. Brothers and sisters, faith is not a one-time event. If you think that if you believe the heavens will part, and you have, lo and behold, you have faith, a faith that rescues, no. Faith is not a mental accent or a declaration that you believe God. That is just the beginning. Another thing, faith is not a feeling that you are certain, that you believe, or being sure that you have faith. No. I will tell you. If there is anything I want you to take away from this talk, are you ready? This is what it is. Faith is a relationship. It is not a singular act of belief. Faith is pregnant with meaning. You know, computer geeks say, you computer geeks out there? You know, it's not even a word. It's not even a document. It is like a zip file. Even more than a zip file. It cannot be contained. Because faith is a verb. It is a verb. It is something you always do. It is an ongoing journey of growing. And that relationship with our Lord is not static. It has chapters, joyful and dark moments. It has chapters of enlightenment. It is a process. Faith will have their ups and downs. And that is what a relationship is. We are all called into a relationship by Jesus. Each of us called in a very personal and unique way. According to where we are, wherever you are called. Whether you're a priest, a mother, a father, a nurse, a farmer, whoever you are, in whatever circumstances you are, wherever you are, God put you there. You are in a perfect place to be having a relationship with Him. Brothers and sisters, don't wish that you had someone else's life or wish for other circumstances in your life. You are in a perfect place and time to become intimate with the living God. So whatever your circumstances, I'll tell you this. Entrust yourself to Him. Look at this. There is a reason why on earth are we called the Pilgrim Church. As pilgrims, we're temporary travelers, journeying, walking with the one who blesses us. The one who said that He is the way, the truth, and the life. Because it is a journey and it takes time. I would say a lifetime. Wherever you are called. Whatever circumstances of events or relationships you have, take that journey and trust yourself through all the different seasons in your life. We all have a unique journey to take, each one of us. And listen to me, to miss that walk with Jesus, is to miss the very essence of our being. And you will miss the greatest adventure that this life had to offer. So walk with Jesus. Why should we walk with Jesus? This is a stark reminder. Because God knows you will sink. We are all called, but we are not perfect. And we will sink. Life is not going to be pleasant. But we need to trust the Lord and we'll always be present and we must be steadfast. Because why? We belong to Him. We will still worship Him. Worship Him in our brokenness and our pain. God is patient. He is faithful. And He will rescue us. And the last verse is, after all the storms, they worship Him and said, when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worship Him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. In the end, if you look back in the past trials of your life, you would conclude that the blessings have come from the most turbulent events in your life. And we will realize that He calms the storms. And in the end, we will come to worship him, for indeed he is God. Let us pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus, for touching us today. Thank you for being a God who rescues. Lord, we ask you to reveal yourself more to us, especially in our broken situations. When we fail or fall and suffer, give us the gift of your Spirit that we may turn more deeply to you, to come to you, and always call upon your name, our Lord and our God. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God bless you, brothers and sisters. Thank you very much. I'll see you in the next feast.
Your will be
Thank you for the wonderful song, Feast Worship. And thank you, Brother Dan, for the inspiring message. We feel so blessed. Brothers and sisters, we have some announcements. Mark your calendar for our talk number 3 on February 19th by Brother Nino Wong, and talk number 4 for this series on February 26th by Brother Alan Montana. Join our Zoomustahan every first Saturday of the month at 3:30 p.m. and invite your friends and family. Our youth ministry invites us to pray the rosary with children every night at 7:30 p.m. Do you need someone to talk with? Our care ministry is willing to listen to you. You can have a one-on-one talk with our team. We invite you to join our ministries and get involved. We are in need of creative, multimedia, connectors, worship, intercessory, and youth ministries. If you are interested in joining, please contact Sis Kathy and Sis Olive. Brothers and sisters, thank you for your financial gift to our community. Together, through your generosity, let's bring God's good news to others. According to Luke chapter 6, verse 38, give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. God cannot be outdone in his generosity. He rewards a cheerful giver. As what 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7 says, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So brothers and sisters, please have your cameras on. We are going to have our group picture taking before we go to our breakout rooms. Okay, page 1, smile. And page 2, smile. There you go. So you have